for finding, recovering, and profiting from gold while recreational prospecting in the state of Washington. A lot of people don't realize it, but there was a lot of gold discovered here in Washington State as late as 1900, and probably the biggest areas where gold was discovered was in the Liberty and Swauk areas near Highway 2 east of Everett and in Blewett Pass. In addition, gold was discovered at the Sultan River at Horseshoe Bend. And back about 100 years ago, the old timers actually carved a tunnel through the bend in the river and diverted the water through the tunnel so that they could mine around the bend in the river. And those guys pulled out 80,000 ounces of gold within a year before the river went back its normal route rather than through the tunnel. And I've actually been up there, and it's a rather interesting place. And here we have some of the equipment that's similar to what the old timers used. This is a black colored plastic gold pan. And you can see here that it has very, very small and narrow riffles on it. And somewhere along in the past, people discovered that a lot of the gold that miners were catching in their pan was floating right over the top of these riffles and back out. And along came the Chinese, and they started hammering dents into these gold pans and made what are called Chinese riffles. And you can see that this has been molded into the shape of the gold pan. When the gold actually runs down here, it catches in these riffles and all the lighter weight material goes off the top and back into the river. And one can easily see that gold pans come in many different sizes as well as many different colors. Now, gold and blue and black colored gold pans are actually the best because gold is yellow. It's like bright yellow paint, and it'll show up against this background very easily. So you can not easily mistake the fact that you have gold in your pan. Let's come on over here and I'll show you some of the interesting equipment that I've got, and we'll talk about this. Now, this is a piece of what's called poop tube or sewer tube, and one can see that it's got ribbed edges on it. It's very flexive. However, when a miner comes back from the river with buckets of black sand, this can be put at about a 30 degree angle, black sand scooped into here with a spoon, and then just a cup full of water poured down here. What happens is all the fine gold from the black sand will catch in these riffles here, and the black sand will go out the other end, and all you have left is gold. Just tip this gently like this into a pan, and then you can pan it out. What we have here is a number two shovel, and this is very, very famous. A number two shovel was what many of the prospectors, especially in the Yukon, brought with them in discovering gold. And very simple construction. I've got this one that's my favorite. And along with that, I need to mention that in the United States of America, there were actually three gold rushes. The first one at Dahlonega, Georgia, back in the early 1800s, followed by the discovery of gold at Sutter's Mill in California, and then later discovery of gold at the Yukon in Alaska in the 1880s. But what a lot of people don't realize is that most of the gold that was discovered in the United States actually was discovered between 1929 and 1940. Because of the Great Depression, thousands and thousands of people were out of work and they had to do something. So a lot of them had grandparents who were in the gold rush, and they went back to the rivers and they actually discovered a lot of the gold that was left behind in tailing piles and other areas that the miners had missed. And they pulled out more gold than at any other time in the United States. And what we have here is what is called a rocker box. And this was made of very, very simple materials, mainly wood and metal. And the old timers back then not only had that, but they had these soft nails that they'd use, kind of like roofing nails. And what we call this in these days is hardware cloth. Some people say it's screen, like for screen door, or critter vent screen, same stuff. And basically they made what was called a hopper. And this was kind of like a little flat bucket. And what the miners would do is they would grab a scoop full of material, and they would take that and they'd dump it through the top of that rocker box. And then another one of the miners would be there with a pan scooping water through it while the other guy was rocking this back and forth. And what this created was artificial wave action. And the gold would actually land down here on the bottom here. And what they used to use was actual moss from trees. They'd line the bottoms of their boxes with that because it would catch the gold and prevent it from getting over the top of these riffles and out of the box. What I have here is a piece of indoor-outdoor carpet, and this is very, very cheap material. You can buy it. It's rubber-backed. Comes at most hardware stores. And this works very, very well for catching real fine pieces of gold. It's almost like tightly woven horsehair. And it is, in a way, an artificial miner's moss. And notice how I've made it so these riffles can lift up and out. That makes cleaning the gold up and the carpet much, much easier. And then, of course, this stuff. This is what we call modern-day plastic miner's moss. And this material is made from furnace vent screen. And here, I have an example of that. This is a piece of used furnace vent screen. If you turn around either side, and you can see it's pretty filthy. And this one was just as bad if I turn it over on this side. And all you had to do was run a hose through it and clean it off, especially just one side. And what I've done is I've taken pieces of this, and I've gone ahead and cut it out for use in my mining equipment. So if any of the gold were to be rushed through here with some fast-moving water, it would be caught in this miner's moss, and I wouldn't lose it and have it go down the other end of the river on me. If we come on over here, I'll show you another neat gadget that is very, very easy to construct. And this is called a sluice box, or a long tong. And again, I've done the same thing. Between the riffles, I've cut out pieces of artificial miner's moss. And what would happen is this material would be shoveled over the top of this screen, and all the sand and the gold would drop through here, and then the miners would push off all the larger rocks, and that gold would float over the top of these riffles and into the pieces of moss, and then be panned out later. The water would come through this end of the box and then rush out that end. Very, very simple construction, easy to make, easy to use, made out of simple 1x4 pine and some nails and hardware cloth. And here we have what is called a modern day sluice box. And this is made by ProMac Tools out of California. And it's made out of simple steel and aluminum. And of course you can see it's got indoor and outdoor carpet. What I've done is I've gone ahead and I've put a laundry detergent bucket on the end of this. And I've gone ahead and cut pieces of hardware cloth that are all different size. This is about 1/4 inch. And I'll show you the inside of the bucket here too. You can see that's 1/8 inch screen mesh also. And what happens is I go ahead and I put this screen into the top of the bucket like this. When I shovel the material into the top of it, the rocks fall off, hit this screen, and then run down and out of my box. That way I'm only left behind with the gold concentrates and the fine black sand. Basically it just filters it out and makes it easier. It stratifies it so I can pan it out much faster. The goal when you go down to a river is to classify and process as much material as you can within the time that you're there. This is a rather interesting box because the front opens up and then comes up like this. And this makes cleaning out the carpet at the bottom very easy. It just slides on out like this. Then that carpet is put into a gold pan, turned upside down, shaken out and rinsed, and then the material is ready to be panned in the river. A lot of miners will save up their pieces of carpet like this, and at the end of the year they'll burn it in a fire and then pan the ashes to get the fine gold out of it. This here is made out of a special type of steel. A lot of it is seen on bumpers on big trucks, and it's welded in place, and it creates artificial wave action also when the water's rushing over the top. This creates a backspin on the water, and the gold drops straight out and on top of the carpet. This top part here is designed so that the bigger rocks will go up and over and out, and again all the black sand lays on top of the carpet. It's where all the fine gold is going to be concentrated. Here at the back of the box, this is the entrance where the water comes through, and you notice I've cut out an area here for the water to go through. But I've left a lip here so that the fine gold doesn't rush back out in case this tips backwards in the river. And I've screwed it in place here with sheetrock screws. Very simple to construct. Normally these cost about $35 to $50. When you go in and you pan, you really don't want to bring anything more than this. If you do get anything larger, usually they'll ask questions, especially if you're going to try and pan at a state park. If you are at a state park, make sure you stop and talk to the ranger first. Let him know what you're doing. Bring your gold panning permit. It's put out by the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife, at least here in the state of Washington. And that will pretty much tell you where you can and can't pan in a river and at what times of the year. So let's go ahead and go down to the river and we'll try some prospecting today and guarantee you that we'll get some gold. We are at the Green River, and as you can see, we brought our equipment with us. But the first thing I need to talk about, and you need to listen carefully about, is safety at a river. As you can notice, I am wearing an inflatable life vest. These were invented during World War II, and they used to call them Mae West vests. A lot of pilots used to wear them. The nice thing about them was they would sit very comfortably here when they weren't inflated. This type of a vest has what's called a panic cord. If I were to pull down on this string right now, this CO2 cartridge would inflate this vest instantly, and I'd be able to stay afloat in the river. If for some reason this were to fail, I have a secondary tube here that I would pull the cork out of and inflate my vest. I would highly recommend that if you're going to bring kids to a river, that not only do you bring a flotation device like this, but also a helmet. Nothing is more dangerous than being caught in the swift current of a river and not being able to swim. The average person is overcome by the cold water within a minute. Limbs start to go numb, and the river with its forceful action can actually force a person underneath boulders and between logs where a person cannot struggle to get themselves free and they drown. Very, very important. Something to think about and consider, safety at a river. And here we are at another spot in the river that I've decided to show you to give you an example of how fast the water actually flows. Right now it's April, and you can see that the water is up pretty far here. By August, the water will have moved out at least 6 feet from this spot. And you can see that the most of the water is traveling probably about 15 miles per hour. You don't want to get caught in that type of a current. You get swept right off your feet. Unless you're wearing a wetsuit and a life jacket, your chances of drowning are pretty good. Please notice that the water slows down around the back side of the rock. It's on the downriver side of those rocks where you'll find gold, because at that point the water can't push it any further. The rock's in the way. A lot of miners will dig under big boulders like this and find big nuggets. But the thing to consider too is the fact that you can undermine a big rock like that and end up having it hurt you or crush you. I actually had this happen to me once, and the boulder landed on my foot and on my gold pan. And luckily I was able to dig my foot out from underneath. Otherwise I'd be walking on an artificial leg at this point. Very important too to see if you can bring someone with you when you go gold panning, because a lot of things can happen. You can also end up running into wild animals such as bear and cougar. Now please notice down here on this beach, we have some rather large sized boulders. And it's down on the back side of these boulders and just underneath where you can see there's a lot of black rock. Whenever you see black rock, which is the heaviest type of rock, made of hematite, magnetite, you're going to find gold. I would definitely try to dig down here. There's some nice tree roots which you catch fine gold, some grasses, a lot of moss, which you'll find gold in as well. And the sand is pretty well washed out, the lighter weight material into the middle of the river, and the heavier black sand is left up here on the beach. I would definitely high bank this area, probably about 6 feet back from the water's edge this way. And we'll go find another area that I call Gold Beach. This happy prospectors, look at how nature tends to renew itself. We've got 11 trees growing out of this one log. You can see you'll find more than just gold when you come out here near a river.
Oh darn it.
check this out, chipmunk holes. And here's one of my other favorite spots, which I call Gold Beach. As you can see, this beach has kind of a curved shape to it, kind of like the upper end of a gold pan. And as a result, all the lighter weight materials ended up back in the center of the river, and all the gold has ended up right here on the beach. I actually came out here last summer and I took a small whisk broom, and I just swept the surface of the beach, and I got quite a bit of gold out of here. Here we have something rather interesting too. This is called Spanish leaf moss, and it grows on a lot of these trees here in the northwest because of the moisture. This type of moss, if you were actually to boil it, you could eat this and survive here in the wilderness. And here we are at my favorite hole. This is where I've found a lot of gold over the years. And today I'm going to show you how to find it, how to recover it, and how to bring it home and show it to the next person so that they can come on out and pan with you next week. This, as you can see, is my favorite sluice box, and I've actually taken a look here at the river. It's come up a little bit since last week when I was here, and I found a spot here where the water is flowing very nicely, but I have to make sure that I put a rock on top of this so it doesn't get floated down river because of the current. Got good water flow here now, coming through the back side of the box and over the top of these ripples. Here we are taking a look at the fast moving water coming down river, and you can see that it's moving at a pretty fast rate, but it tends to slow down here right near these rocks. This is where you'd also find gold if you wanted to take a look. Coming back out this way, you can see there's trees and a lot of grasses and moss, and this is where gold has a tendency to float out and get stuck. This is another one of my favorite areas here because there's a huge boulder here. It's probably the size of a car. And directly underneath the boulder, you can see it's rather hollow. If you take a look underneath here, if you were to take a pan and a shovel and dig out from under here, you'd probably find a nice sized nugget. Again, you can see where the water has slowed down here, and then all of a sudden it drops back into the rapids. It's where it slows down here near my sluice box where the gold has a tendency to rest. Here you can see an area that I've started to dig out. This area is right with a whole bunch of trees and small boulders. What I believe used to be a small stream entering this river. So at this point I started to dig and I found quite a bit of good gold. When you start finding white rocks and black rocks in your pan, the which are the heaviest, made of quartz, you're going to find good gold. I'm going to go ahead and grab some concentrate out of here. We're going to bring down the river and pan it out, and I'll show you. Today we're going to learn effective panning methods, how to take care of our tools, and we're also going to show how we take care of the environment. One of the things that gold miners are in constant battle with are people who say that we make a mess out of the environment because we dig holes like this. The most important thing to remember is, as environmentalists ourselves, if we have garbage that we bring to the river, we need to pack it out and bring it home. If we find other people's garbage here, we need to pack out their garbage and bring it home. And before we leave, fill in holes like this. One argument, which is correct, that a lot of these people use, is that salmon get caught in holes like this and they can't get back out and they die as a result. So we want to remember, take good care of the river, keep our hobby of gold prospecting going for a long time. One of the things I forgot to mention was, when I come to the river, I bring these nice little gardening tools with me. This is like a cat's claw. It works really well for going through material without ending up with cuts on your fingers. Keep in mind that where you find gold, you're going to find pieces of broken glass, bullet shells, and fish hooks. You don't want to get those stuck in your hands. Please go ahead and notice the different types of rocks that are in this hole. This one is dark green. It's called serpentine, and it's extremely heavy, just like hematite and magnetite and quartz. A lot of these rocks were pushed down from Canada during the Ice Age here in Washington State and deposited as alluvial gravels. It is because of this action brought by the glaciers that a lot of gold was pushed down in these gravels into Washington State and deposited here in our soils. Rocks like this that are nice and heavy and flat, if you take a look underneath them and dig them out, you can usually find good material. And I'll go ahead and show you. Notice I put my pan at the bottom of the hole to catch my concentrate. I'm starting to see a lot of fine sand and dark rocks. You notice these are flat and they're very dark colored. Where you start finding rock like that, you're going to find gold. Notice it's dark green and dark black. There's also tree roots here. Where you find tree roots, you're going to find gold also, because it kind of acts like fingers and it grabs hold of the gold as the water's going over the top of it. Now, I've found that a lot of this gold has not moved far from the source vein. It is jagged edged and not rounded and flat like most gold that will wash down a river from a far distant source. When you find gold that has jagged edges, it hasn't traveled far from the source vein. Something very important to think about. Most of the gravels here in Washington State are deposited because of the glacial ice age, as I mentioned. However, when that ice came through and broke through a lot of our quartz that had gold veins in it, it exposed a lot of that area, and a lot of it is still around here. A lot of people will actually stake a claim and follow a map that they make by hand using a shovel, and they'll decide how many grains of gold per shovelful they'll find, and they'll map it out until they find the source vein. Okay, if you take a look here, I've got a couple panfuls of good concentrate ready to go. This is something to consider. If you have a partner, one person could be down at the river panning while the other one's getting the next load of concentrate. The goal, again, is to try and process as much material as you can per hour to get as much gold as possible. Now I'll talk to you about correct canning method. Notice that I have gone ahead and I put my gold pan completely underwater. This is extremely important because this soil has a lot of clay in it. And the goal here is to get the water into the clay and stir it up, break up as much clay as possible. One of the things that the old timers did a long time ago was lose their gold because they'd allow too much clay to accumulate in their gold pan or in their sluice boxes, and it would wash right down river or roll the gold up and walk right out of the sluice box. Now I'm going to go ahead and put my hand in here. There's plenty of rock in this soil to keep the gold pan on the bottom so it won't float away while I'm trying to do this. That way any gold that's on the top of my pan goes immediately to the bottom because it's as heavy as lead. It has a specific gravity of 19 and it's the heaviest element on the chart of the periodic elements. You notice some of the rocks I'm getting are round and flat and black. You want to pay attention to the type of rocks that you're getting in your pan. That'll tell you if you're in a good area or not. Notice how I'm swirling the pan around. My daughter calls this making chocolate milk. You can see why. The water gets pretty muddy. Notice the color of a lot of these rocks in the pan. They're dark. At this point, I just gently dip and maybe get a little water in there. Go back and slap some of those rocks. See how pretty some of those are. That dark green serpentine is a very heavy rock. Then I'll back swill the water like this, pinch in, make sure I get that clay broken up that's in the first ripple in my pan. Then I'll continue to stir up that mud. What's happening here is lighter weight material is going off the top and out to the river. Heavier weight material, which is black sand and gold, is left behind, as well as some garnets, which are semi-precious stones. You can see there's some quartz, red quartz agate, some green serpentine, some black hematite, very heavy rock. At this point, you want to check the ripples in your pan to see if you have any nuggets. And again, I'll switch that around. Now I'm going to give you a close-up of exactly what we have in our pan here. Notice that red material? That's either garnet or what's called chert. This is white quartz and some more black hematite and a lot of black sand. Again, we're looking at the type of material in our pan. We got white quartz rock. We got little pieces of red garnet, which is a semi-precious stone, which is used in sandblasting and making sandpaper and precious jewelry, and a lot of black sand. And it's under this black sand that the gold is hiding. Now what I'm going to do is show you that you want to just leave a little bit of water in your pan and twirl it around to get the gold out from up on these ripples. Right here I can see a couple pieces just sitting there by themselves. We would have lost that if we weren't being careful here. I'll shake all that gold back down to the middle of my pan. I have too much water in my pan, so I'll pour off a little bit. Only need enough to cover the bottom, basically. I'll bring it up there and I'll shake it so the lighter weight material goes back off just like it does in the river. If we were standing on the beach, this is where the gold would be. And I'm already starting to see some gold appear here. in a good area. And I'll push that up to the top of my pan there. You see some nice pieces starting to appear already here. Oh, they're all over. What I'm going to do, because I have a lot of experience doing this, is I'm going to go ahead and pan out the rest of this so I get down to just a little bit of black sand and gold. At this point, I'm just dipping slowly. I'm not going real fast with this, because I don't want to lose the material that I have in my pan. I'll shake it down in the middle there. Again, we're seeing some pretty red rock in there. A lot of that gold wind right up here in that edge. Black sand. Nice pieces. The goal here is to separate the gold from the sand without losing the gold. Black sand has a tendency to bury the gold very, very quickly. Or as some people say, hide it. What I do is I push the gold up into a nice, neat little pile. Makes it easier to see. You can take a look here. And you can see it's all formed up into this one little area. That's the real McCoy. Next step, I'll show you how to save it in a glass bottle. You take a look here and you can see there's the real McCoy. Now I got to figure out how to put it inside a small bottle. If you have a friend who's an insulin diabetic, have them save the little glass bottles for you. You put your gold in them, as well as the metal tubes that their plastic blood test strips come in. I always bring those down here to the river with me. We'll go ahead and go do that. Okay, here we have our little glass diabetic insulin bottle that I talked about. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to dry off my fingertip, and I'm going to go up here to where the gold is in the pan, and I'm going to press that against my finger and then touch the top of the water. And you can see how rapidly that gold sinks out inside that little bottle. And I'll check my finger to make sure no gold is sticking to it before I dry it off again. And we'll go ahead and, very important that you always pan out your concentrates a second time so you don't miss the gold. And always check these upper ripples to make sure no gold is stuck there. And then shake it down to the center of the pan, making sure you don't have too much water in there, maybe just a half a cup full. Just enough to cover the bottom of the pan. Swirl it up to the edge, then back shake it. When you back shake it, it does the same thing that the river does on a beach. And again, you can see I've got some gold here I missed the first time around. I'll move that up to the edge of my pan, and then I'll run that water over the top and try and backwash that black sand so I can separate my gold out much easier. See, I got three nice pieces there. At $425 an ounce, it pays to save every little piece that you find. Again, here we go. Dry your finger off. Touch the pieces of gold. Make sure they're on there. And come over to the bottle and gently touch the top where the water is. The gold will sink right out very rapidly to the bottom of that bottle. make sure that you check your finger afterwards to make sure none of the gold is stuck there, as well as to the top edge of the bottle. Before we leave today, please take a look at the concentrates I found here. A lot of these rocks, if you notice, are very small black rocks. A lot of them are flattened. You get them wet, you can take a look. Those are the heaviest type of rocks. Where you find that, you'll find gold. I'm going to go ahead and pan this out and take a look, see if those fine, nice little black rocks. Good indicator that there's gold right there. Go ahead and pan that out, see what we come up with. Notice I'm doing it underwater first, keeping the pan level. This way I'm getting all the heavier stuff to the bottom, all the lighter weight material to the top. Once I'm pretty confident that's happened, then I'll gently swirl it in either a clockwise or a counterclockwise direction. It doesn't matter if you're left-handed or right-handed, it'll work either way. Taking a look at some of the colored rocks in my pan. You can see a lot of them are very dark. Some of them are very light, meaning they're white quartz, which are heavy like gold. Where you find those rocks, you will find gold. Need to reach in here and break up that clay in the bottom, the ripple. And at this point, we gently dip at a 40 degree angle. Anything steeper than that, you can lose your gold in the river. Try and pick out the big rocks in this clay. We just pan down to the fine black sand. Backwards, get all that lighter weight material washed towards the back of the pan. This stratifies the black sand away from the gold. And I've already seen a few pieces showing up here in the edge. Nice and bright. I'll kind of push all that together with my finger. We'll get a close-up view of our gold. Nice sized pieces there. Definitely something to write home about. Now we'll go put them in our bottle. Believe it or not, I've got the gold here on the end of my fingertip. Again, I had to dry off my finger before I touched the gold in the pan. And now I've made sure that the bottle is completely full. Once I touch that gold to the top of the bottle's water, the adhesion will be broken and it'll drop to the bottom. The reason these little gold flakes float on top of water is because of the salmon that swim through these streams. They leave their oils behind, as well as the oil from cars that come out of street sewers and into the river. And this keeps the gold floating on the surface until the adhesion is broken by water action or some sort of a soapy detergent meets it. A lot of gold panners will go ahead and bring out a little bottle of dishwashing soap and mix it in their pan when they're actually looking for the gold. It helps keep the gold from floating back on top of the water and going out in the pan. Now watch as I touch the top and see how fast that gold sinks to the bottom. See that? pretty exciting. The real McCoy.
I'm going to show you a picture of my father, who happens to have the gold panning disease. He's got it really bad. He's still trying to figure out how to get those little chunks of gold out of the bottom of the pan. And I'll go ahead and describe that to you in one simple step. A lot of people will go ahead and bring sandwich pegs down to the river with them with a big fat stereo magnet inside the bag. And what they'll do is they'll dip that sandwich bag into the bottom of their pan, and they'll pull out all the magnetite, which is basically the black sand, out of the bottom of their pan so that they can go ahead and recover the gold. This is one of the mistakes that beginners make. They have too much material in the bottom of their pan, and they just don't know how to get the gold out. Also, one of the exciting things about gold prospecting is the fact that it's a very cheap hobby. All it costs is about $8 for a pan about this size, and of course your gas and your time. That's about it. I can't think of any other hobby that's as satisfying. It's away from telephones and computers, and where you can take a look at nature and really feel at home. Look at how beautiful the river is. Well, Dad, did you find any gold there?
Little pieces.
Anything you want to write home about or show Mom?
Well, I can always show her. I'd rather do that than write about it.
Well, all you have to do is figure out how to get it out of the bottom of your pan.
Yep.
So we'll go ahead and do that.
Okay.
One thing I'm going to tell these folks too, Dad, is a lot of these boulders around here are covered with a fine carpet of moss. And if you take a look at it, it looks like miner's moss, like what we talked about, made out of that furnace filter material. A lot of people come along with a little vacuum cleaner and they'll vacuum this moss and get gold out of it. The park rangers discourage people from pulling this moss off of rocks, turning it upside down in their pan and letting it float down river, because it takes such a long time for this stuff to grow. And it's quite beautiful out here. Any luck yet?
Three pieces separated out.
Only three?
So far.
Are you going to make it rich now?
No. I'm having a lot of fun though.
Well, that's the important thing. Let's take a break and have some lunch.
Why not?
Hey, Dad, why don't you tell us about what you're learning today down here at the river and about gold prospecting?
Well, first of all, for me, it's always fun to learn something new. When you're as old as I am, it's nice to have one of your own children say to you, hey, come on with me, I'll show you something. Let's try to find something, some gold. And of course, at first I was very doubtful. But then gradually, after coming here three or four times, I've begun to learn what to look for. It's very elusive, but it's there in the pan. Now I have to get to the next step, trying to get it out of the pan and into the bottle. And that's where my son is trying to teach me a new trick.
That's right. Do you think you're going to make any money at this today?
No.
Why are you out here?
I enjoy the nature. I enjoy the challenge of learning something new.
That's good. Well, maybe we can show these folks how to do it.
Let's try.
As you can see here, I've got another pan of concentrates. Now that Dad has recovered from his gold fever, I'm going to go ahead and pour this through the bucket here in the top of his sluice box, and you'll be able to see how the black sand separates out from the rest of the material. And I can pour the water as slowly as I want to. What's happening is that black sand is going to separate from the clay and the other rocks due to tree roots. And then those bigger rocks are going to end up moving out inside of the sluice box there. One thing I should have brought with me to the river was a pair of good rubber boots. there. And then all I'm left behind with is sand and gold. See, with two people, you can certainly move a lot more material through something like this. One person shoveling, another person pouring water through. We'll go ahead and take a look here. Down here at the bottom, you can see there's a lot of fine sand and mud still. That's where our material is going to be concentrated in. If I move this rock, you'll be able to see just how that water moves up and over. It's even flow even out the side of the box. The goal here is to try and catch that water that goes over the top of those ripples. Left behind black sand. Now what I want to make sure I do is put a gold pan at the bottom of this so that when I go ahead and I move my carpet, any gold that's in the bottom of that sluice will end up in my pan and not in the river. Hold this carpet very carefully. I want the gold to go in the pan and not in the river. Any gold that's resting on the surface of the carpet. You can see there's still a lot of fine clay and other material in there. So I need to pan that out. Make sure my gold's at the bottom and not my dad is there's only one cure for gold fever, and that is to make sure you come back to the river and find more gold. Just because you have one little tiny piece in a whole panful, that's not uncommon.
what I am going to show you, I'm going to come over here and I'm going to grab some of that moss off those rocks, and I'm going to turn it upside down in my pan and show you how much gold you can get out of it.
Here we are looking at the moss that's on top of some of these rocks, and I've gone ahead and peeled some of it off to show you what's underneath. You can see fine, fine black pebbles. Gold is going to be in here. You can just gently massage the top of those rocks to remove that dirt. Try and get it into your pan. If you can sweep it into your pan, you're going to find it. See how it comes up over the top of the rock and gets stuck here? That's that fine moss acting like a carpet. If I want to retrieve some of that, I just need to make sure I sweep it into my pan, see? Now, I'm not going to take any more than that because it takes so long for this stuff to grow. But I want you to keep in mind that there is gold in moss. And I'm going to go ahead and pan this out to show you.
Here I am taking it and putting it in my pan, rinsing it out like it's a wig. And I'll toss that down river, it'll actually stick to other rocks and replant itself. Again, I don't have one of those special vacuum cleaners that some people have. They actually wear it like a backpack and come down here and they vacuum the moss. See all the fine material that's inside that moss? Quite a bit. Notice how I back shake it gently? Now you can see some of the gold start to show up right here. And that moss. Pretty exciting. But again, I don't want to try and destroy too much stuff around here because that's the kind of stuff that people don't enjoy who are real strict environmentalists. So we'll go ahead and clean up for today. Very important to remember not only to pack out your garbage and fill in your holes, but also to take care of your equipment. Even though it's cheap, you want to have it for next time when you come on out so you have fun. Until then, I'm Sluicebox Sean. Thank you for joining me for finding gold in Washington State.
Well, here we are. I thought the end of the film had come, but I was up there digging in the hole again. I had gold fever myself. And I happened to find a nice size nugget. Take a look at the size of that compared to my finger. Give me an idea of how, in just a couple hours, a person could definitely make some good, serious money here off of gold. There is plenty of gold here in Washington, and this is the proof. Again, thank you for joining me. I'm Sluicebox Sean. Thank you for watching Finding Gold in Washington State.